like to welcome you on the presentation for a test case of offshore wind park operation. We have been starting to talk about test cases very early in this action, and it has been some time until we really developed a test case, and this is what I would like to present now. Where we are working with structural health monitoring, and we are basing our action, our research here on what has been done in the last decades. And well, that's why we can say traditionally SHM is focused on loadings or structural reactions to monitor this in structural systems, but also internal structural properties. However, in the perspective of that we should address the value of structural health monitoring or the utility in conjunction with the utility of infrastructures, then we also must say that the value for society is highly related to the functionality and the benefits earned with infrastructures. So we need also to include this utility in our modeling. And at the same time, the value or the utility for society can only be realized when costs and risks are sufficiently low. So that's why our value of information analysis should build upon a benefit, cost, and risk-informed assessment of the infrastructure performance. And this is the perspective I'm going to take here in this presentation. And where we have been seeing this in the last presentation, I think it was on the first slide. An overview about the framework and related to different system states. We have the intact systems. Here we have a system under exposure events, under constituent damage states and system damage states accounting for the scenarios. And then for each of the system states, we can quantify consequences, benefits in terms of economy, health, and environment. And with a consistent formulation, we may be able to formulate such a utility function and to optimize our actions. When we have a closer perspective in terms of the value of information and the structural health monitoring, we see that we have various strategies here for monitoring the intact system, hazard threats, constituent damage states, and system damage states. So this is symbolized with a mini Bayesian network here with the observation node. This would be a decision node, and this is a cost node. So this is symbolizing the SHM decision information, precision, and cost. And what we also have developed is a decision tree for value of information analysis that goes to the fact sheet by Dimitri Wahl and Robbie Kaspeler, I think, also, and Cheng Xing. So the very basic representation of a value of information analysis and compassing experiments or SHM strategies, the outcomes of the SHM, then actions and system states. This is the very basic formulation of a value of information analysis, a very basic decision tree. This is what we have to account for when we are doing a value of information analysis, and we then calculate the value of information as the optimal utility for doing structural health monitoring, or minus the optimal utility when not doing structural health monitoring. Or we can also have the related value of information, which is then just divided by the utility, optimal utility without doing structural health monitoring. So, well, we have both. We have a visualization of the framework. First, my first slide, and now we have this decision tree. So where is the connection? The connection is the system states. So it's this branch here, and it's these system states which we find in the framework, and here also. So this was basically the introduction, shortly outlining the framework, how we can use it, and now we take the perspective of offshore wind park operation. That's a very actual problem, as there have been substantial investments in Europe in wind parks in the last decade, and now the focus of the industry is on operation, because that's crucial for energy efficiency. This is very important for society, but it's also about the economy of operating the wind parks and for earning money, for earning benefits. And but the last point is there's a large number of identical structures, so that's unusual to what we normally have. We have rather unique structures. There's not a high number of identical structures in civil engineering. And exactly this was something I came across when I started working in the field of offshore wind energy 10 years ago. So there's a large number of identical structures, and there is dependencies. To define a decision situation or a decision scenario, we can think of that an operator wants to assess in the commissioning phase of an offshore wind park what amount of data needs to be collected to facilitate a service life extension. We will see in a few slides why a service life extension is something which the industry is after. But that's the usual situation. We have been in contact with a few wind park operators, which are also included here in our action. So it's the commissioning phase. The investment has been done. And of course, the operator aims at the highest utility throughout the service life. That's the decision objective. And well, the solution is SHM systems, but which one? And well, then there are all kinds of questions, which is which SHM system, at how many turbines, at which locations, and at which locations in one wind turbine. So well, this is all open questions. So let's take basis in this decision scenario, and let's have a look at the intact system state. The intact system state is characterized by power production and operation costs. So there's an income due to power production. So here we have the parameters like the capacity of the wind turbine, the nominal capacity, then availability factor of this wind turbine, and then there is a factor of the nominal capacity when it is available, because that depends on the wind speed, on the mean wind speed. And then there's numbers, percentages or what needs to be invested in the wind park operation yearly. And then there is a discount rate. So with these numbers, this is on a very generic level, but still we can do here a cost-benefit analysis. And we see that there is a return over investment over 20 years operation of 15%, and 25 years it's 30%. So, well, this is exactly why operators are requesting service life extension also already in the commissioning state. And this goes exactly to the challenge I've outlined. So in the last years, these systems can be very efficient and can help to earn money. So when we just take this cost-benefit analysis, then structural health monitoring is seen as something which goes against the benefits. So why should we do this? And this is the situation I've been experienced over years, that the discussions are always going to the direction, why should I use SHM? Then there's a lot of people which can do SHM, which can implement very well systems, which can analyze data. This is very, very developed, but the benefit, the utility of SHM is unclear. So, but we also need to look at the other system states, like the exposures. So, I'm considering here extreme exposure events and fatigue. So I narrow down the context for this test case. There's of course more. Structural performance models. There's also corrosion and so on. But let's look to fatigue and extreme exposure events. Well, fatigue is caused by the environmental loadings, winds and waves, and in conjunction with the operation. And extreme events may be caused also by extreme winds in combination with extreme waves, normal and abnormal operation. So this is some of the basic assumptions. The wind turbine fatigue damage is characterized with the fatigue design factor of 2.5. So that should be that should characterize a wind turbine fatigue damage. We have many components there, and so the usual fatigue design factor is between 2 and 3. And we also characterize the wind turbine failure with the failure probability of 5 × 10⁻⁴. This is in line with the JCSS basis of design for minor consequences, because a wind park has only economic consequences, and we can, on this level, neglect any consequences in regarding to human safety and also the environment. So, in a wind park, any of the wind turbine can be damaged or can fail. So we are considering a wind park of 50 wind turbines. So that's why we have to take here a serious system model to model the fact that there can be a fatigue damage or a failure at any of the system constituents. And we account also for a correlation of 0.8. So when one turbine is damaged or has failed, then there can be a failure of the wind park, or a damage or a failure of a wind park. And we are also accounting for this cascading event with the brittle Daniell system, also utilizing a correlation of 0.8. And it's brittle because there is production capacity loss after failure. The consequences in case that the wind park fails is that when it is damaged, it's part of the wind park investment, it's 1%. If it was, if it fails, then the consequences is the wind park investment, and there's also the production loss as a consequence. So this is the damage or failure probability here on this axis, and this is the service life in years. So we have it until 25 years here, and where the probabilities of complete system damage or system failure are significantly lower than the failures and damages of one of these wind turbines. Now coming to the SHM strategies. So we can think of an SHM strategy, also highly simplified here. We are monitoring each of the wind turbine. We may be able to monitor the fatigue loading, so that goes to the exposure at each wind turbine location. And we can utilize here a model for the fatigue loading in the context of the pre-posterior decision analysis, meaning that we are assuming that the model uncertainties have realized here for the fatigue loading in the fatigue damage model. The second SHM strategy can be hotspot monitoring. So here we would also measure very locally at each of the wind turbine structure. And here we assume that more model uncertainties have been realized have been realized because the structure is there. So then we say that the loading model uncertainty, the far field stress uncertainty, and the hotspot stress uncertainty are realized. So this is the way of modeling the SHM data in conjunction with the design models, which we are already having. And we can think of a third SHM strategy where we model the extreme system loading. The SHM precision is accounted for. So we have limited precision. I think it's a standard deviation of 10% normally distributed. And we also account for the statistical uncertainties. So again, a simplified model. So we are assuming to start monitoring in the first year of the service life. But if you just have 1 year of measurement and we do a statistical analysis, we have very high statistical uncertainties because we just have one observation. And then the statistical uncertainty decreases as I'm collecting in the consecutive service life more observations. So this is accounted here in this model form. And then structural health monitoring is about costs. So we have been assuming an investment of 500,000 euros, installation also 500,000 euros, operation 20,000 euros per annum. And we also assumed here a replacement interval of 10 years. I've been involved in tenders for SHM systems where this is, was not accounted for, but it's rather obvious that 10 years is rather high lifetime for a SHM system. Okay, SHM strategies. So then we come to the decision tree. So now we are back into our value of information analysis and the generic decision tree. We have here now SHM, that's E0, that's our prior decision analysis. And then we have the three SHM strategies, 1, 2, and 3 would also follow here. By how we modeled the SHM results or outcomes, we have no indications. So if indications are related to probability of detection. So we don't have this branch here, but we have the action branch. This is A0 is service life 20 years as it was designed. And A1 is a service life extension to 25 years. And then we have the system states. So that's the overlap with the framework. We have a safe state. We have wind turbine damage or failure or wind park damage or failure. So this is the decision tree we are going to analyze. And when we have done that, we can quantify the relative value of information. So for SHM strategy, it's 18%, 2 is 31%, and 3 would be 0.7%. How does it look like in more detail? So that's the decision tree only considering the experiments. So SHM here, SHM strategy 1, 2, and 3 here. And we see the utilities for each of the actions. And it's interesting to observe here the utility for our prior decision analysis. It is not optimal to extend the service life because we'll see this in the slide later. The risks are too high here. Here in the prior decision analysis, taking no SHM information, the A0 is optimal here, and the same number like here should also be here. Sorry, that's a mistake. When we look at SHM strategy 1, so that was fatigue load monitoring, then we see it has been it was shifted. So it's now the highest utility is here in this branch related to action A1 to service life extension. So looking further at SHM strategies 2 and 3, we have the same picture here for SHM strategy. Optimal action is A1, service life extension, and for SHM strategy E3, so that was the extreme system load monitoring, we see that the optimal action is not to extend the service life. So that's further breakdown of the results. We have the expected benefits over 20 years. That's the utility for the optimal prior decision. So we have the expected benefits here. We have indirect risks here going to system damage and failure, and the direct risks here going to wind turbine damage and failure. So when we look at the utility for the optimal pre-posterior decision, so that's related to SHM strategy 2, then we observe first now that we have a service life of 25 years and that the indirect risks and the direct risks have been substantially reduced, especially the indirect risks here in comparison to the previous slide. So, this was rather complete for SHM strategies 1 to 3, but looking at one of the first slides here for the intact system, we see that we have factors like the wind park operation here. and also the availability factor. So I thought it would be good to explore what if we could also reduce the wind park operation costs, or we could provide a higher availability of the turbine. So if our SHM systems can also influence actions related to the availability and to the wind park operation. So I calculated here for more efficient wind park operation, there would be a related benefit of 2.6%. And if we can achieve lower downtimes or a higher availability by 10%, then we can achieve a value of information of 15%. And the interesting thing to note here is also that as we are in the in the parameters of the cost-benefit analysis, then we see also in the cost-benefit analysis for the intake test system the effect of SHM strategies. Of course, well, when we think more about that, more efficient wind park operation, so lower number of inspections, for instance, we also have an interrelation by the observations we are accounting for and the risks, meaning the direct and indirect risks. This is a modeling issue which we have not been accounting for here, but in other publications. So, to conclude, this is a test case to be further developed by adding complexity and to calibrate, to assess and to illustrate issues of interest in the future, to calibrate also to case studies. From the test case here, from the basic modeling I've been presenting, we can conclude that the wind park service life extension may only be optimal with relevant information, with a relative high precision. And I think this is also a very important aspect. There's a wide range of SHM strategies, not just about the loading and internal structural properties, but taking a wider perspective, including different system states, the intake system, how can structural health monitoring be beneficial for the operation? I think there's a large potential. I would also like to explicitly address the working group interaction. So this is what I was referring to in the opening presentation. So we should also work together across working groups. So we hope for working group two, this test case may be an orientation and inspiration of how we can build SHM strategies and structural performance models together. For working group three and four, it may be starting points for each of their challenges. One for working group three is tools and also adding complexity to the models. And working group four is for the case studies. So what we will do further is to use our network to get feedback. So this is why I'm standing here and requesting feedback. But we will also address wind park operators here in our network, which are not here today. Where we will further develop, and then I think there should be further test cases. We have identified at the very beginning reinforced concrete structures. So we would need a test case here as a starting point. But I've been observing in the last workshops that there is a lot of people working from different sites for concrete dams and also earth dams and levees. So this could be another field for developing test cases. Thank you for your attention.